When Anne Sperling was a child, she had every conceivable version of a farm tool in child size, a hoe, a shovel, and so on, so that she could help on her family's farm in BC to help make wine. Now that she's a winemaker at Niagara's Southbrook Vineyards, she says she has an intuitive feel for the vines, and that when she walks among them, she can tell within seconds their age and vitality, kind of like the vine whisperer. Anne, welcome.
Hi.
Now your intuitive sense for winemaking is very much part of your approach to farming, which is biodynamics. Can you tell us a little bit about how biodynamics differs from organics when it comes to making wine?
Well, I guess a simple way of looking at it is it's like extreme organics. So biodynamics is an organic form of farming, but instead we have fewer products from that we buy in to make the operation work. So there's something called a whole farm system or a whole farm concept, where the idea is that we raise or grow as many of the inputs as we need to make our vineyard healthy.
Okay. And there's a lot of talk about biodynamics, perhaps a lot of misunderstanding. Some people characterize it as witchcraft for winemaking, or astrological, because there's stars and sun and moon are involved. I've even heard of burying the cow's horns with manure in the vineyard. Do you do that?
Well, yes, in fact, we do. That's known as Preparation 500. And the compost that results from that process of burying the horn with fresh cow manure inside it is that we get a very highly concentrated microbial mix within that compost, and we can use it as like a starter culture to invigorate our soils with the right microorganisms to that then serves the vines to supply the nutrition.
And now I know that this approach helps with the vine health, but do you really taste a difference that biodynamics makes, like in the taste of the wine?
Well, yes, we do, for sure. And I've seen it we had a wonderful example a couple of years ago with Chardonnay. And we had the opportunity to ferment a few barrels for another winery and within our winery. So they had conventionally grown grapes, and we had our biodynamic grapes. And when we tasted those barrels side by side, what was really obvious was the texture and the complexity of the biodynamic wine compared to the conventional one, which was much simpler. And, you know, by the numbers, if you just looked at the alcohol or the acidity, there were some similarities, but really when the difference came when you put the wine in your mouth.
Wow. And so that's more a result of the vines and the grapes following seasonal changes as opposed to chemical ones, is it?
Well, yes. Yeah. So what we see with conventional vineyards where chemical fertilizers are kind of dominant is that it really drives the vine. So you get early lush growth, and then you get the vine just kind of being manipulated by the chemicals rather than responding to the seasonal cycles that, you know, as summer approaches, the days get longer, and then as fall approaches, the days get shorter. And a vine really should respond to that and start the ripening process, for example, as the days are getting shorter, and mature the seeds within the berries so that by the end of the fall that those seeds are mature. But also what that's a sign of is that the flavors are mature within the berries.
It sounds like a detox program for vines, kind of like they've been in rehab and now they're, you know, healthy and living free kind of thing.
There is some of that, because there's actually a UC Davis study that shows that after a period of time with organic and biodynamic viticulture practices in place, that the vines do develop their own resistance and their own resiliency. And this can be proven with by looking at, for one element would be the thickness of the skins. And so because of that stimulation of the skin surface, kind of like a suntan for humans, the berries are actually healthier. But where it affects wine is with red wine, for example, if you have thick skins and well-developed tannins, that means better color and more flavor and texture in the wine.
And so is it harder to do biodynamic farming or even organic farming in a cool climate like Ontario, where you have more mildew and rot and pests, say, than down in Chile, where it's warm and, you know, they have lots of irrigation and so on? Is it tougher up here?
Well, in Niagara, we definitely have a humid climate, and we see in all vineyards in the region kind of every mildew and mildew-related pest known to viticulture. So it's a challenging region to grow grapes in. But in fact, we find that now that we have our systems in place and our vines are in that state of having their own resiliency, that we're producing our crops cleaner and more consistently than often conventional farmers are doing. So in a conventional situation, things seem to be more erratic, and when you get a string of bad weather, often the fruit will rot very quickly. Whereas in our situation, we're always managing and we're just staying ahead of things enough that that the fruit stays healthy and we always, you know, are harvesting high quality fruit.
So there are so many benefits, you know, richer or more authentic wine in terms of expressing where it comes from. Why aren't more Ontario wineries and wineries across Canada adopting this? I know increasingly there are, but it's still a very small percentage of producers who take this approach.
Even though biodynamics has been around since the 1920s, it hasn't been part of the conventional training. So, for example, you can't go to any enological or viticultural program that offers a degree in Canada or the U.S. and study biodynamics. You have to go to special schools for it or take special courses. So it's not in the mainstream, we'll say, but so anyone who's really interested in it has to pursue their learning, you know, themselves and with a lot of motivation. But it's interesting because there is a lot of interest from our students that are coming out of like the Niagara College and the Brock programs. So every year we bring in new interns and we try to train them and expose them to our method of farming, because it is it is a very clean way of farming, and when you spend, you know, much of your time and most of our lives at work, and we have people that spend every day during the spring, summer, and fall within the vines. So so as an employer, it's a great way to feel good about, you know, offering the best kind of conditions for all the workers.
Absolutely.
And there actually have been some studies recently, a couple of them out of France, that have shown that vineyard pesticides from conventional farming are showing up in the older farm workers and causing neurological problems for them.
My goodness, wow, that is serious stuff.
Yeah.
So what is your next big project? You've always got something on the go. What's up next for you, either at Southbrook or some of the other properties that you're involved with?
Well, Southbrook is an ongoing project for me, and we do have a lot of things on the go, including our flock of sheep as well as our winemaking. But as far as personally goes, I have a couple of projects that I'm excited about. My husband and I have had a very small vineyard in Argentina where we grow Malbec, and so our wine that will be called Versado will be new on the market in Ontario later this year. So we're doing all of the steps that leads us to bringing that wine into Canada. And then as well, my family's vineyard in the Okanagan Valley called Sperling Vineyards, we're launching our sparkling wine. So we started that program in 2008, and so after 3 years on the lees, our classical method sparkling will be available also late this fall.
Wow, three time zones. When do you sleep, Anne?
Oh, I sneak it in here and there.
during the solstice.
Yeah.